This video visualizes cubical marching squares. It's an algorithm to create triangle meshes from representations such as sine distance fields, point clouds, sine distance functions, or even remeshing an existing mesh. Now let's see how the algorithm works. First, let's remind how marching cubes works. We find or estimate intersection points on edges and then connect them with triangles to form surfaces. Cubical marching squares takes a different approach. The cube is decomposed into squares. Now we can use marching squares algorithm on each of face squares. We find the line segments on each face, and when we fold the cube back together, we get a segment loop. Finally, another vertex is created to form a triangle fan. This alone doesn't change much. We got rid of the massive lookup table, but the generated mesh is basically the same as with marching cubes. Next, we'll cover other changes compared to marching cubes. Let's start with a simple cube and a uniform grid. First, we sample at each corner of the cells and record the signs of those values as a Boolean. Now we find the intersection point on each edge with a sign change, marked yellow. This data would get us the same mesh as before. To preserve sharp features, we need to generate new vertices. Why? Because currently we only place vertices on edges, but the sharp features are not on edges. To calculate these new vertex locations, we need normals at the intersection points, marked green. We decompose the cell into faces as we did before and use marching squares. This time we create a new vertex to capture the sharp feature. If the normals were in roughly the same direction, then there would be no sharp feature and we connect the edges as usual. To calculate the new vertex, we have to find the tangent vectors. In 2D, this is trivial. You can swap the coordinates and negate one of them. The new vertex is the intersection point of the tangent lines. Mathematically, this is equivalent to inverting a 2x2 matrix. Or in other words, you have to find the point where both line equations are satisfied simultaneously. Folding the quads back together now gets us a segment loop with preserved sharp feature. This is now done for each cell in the grid. Now we need to form a triangle fan from this segment loop, but where do we put the central vertex? We could calculate the average position of each vertex in the segment loop, but this wouldn't preserve the sharp feature. We do the 3D equivalent of what we just did in 2D. An equation in 2D represents a line, but in 3D it represents a plane. The intersection points and their normals let us form these plane equations. Here we have three plane equations. We place the vertex at the intersection point of these planes. Mathematically, this is equivalent to inverting a 3x3 matrix. Now we can form a triangle fan, preserving the sharp feature. If the normals point in roughly the same direction, then there is no intersection point. In that case, we use the average position as the central vertex, because there is no sharp feature. But there's another case. What if you only have two plane equations? Average position wouldn't capture the sharp feature, but there is no unique point to place the vertex. Here we have four intersection points, but only two unique plane equations. The intersection between two planes is a line in 3D space, not a point. We can only form a 2x3 matrix here, which can't be inverted. What we can do instead is to use the Moore-Penrose pseudo-inverse. Also, we should place the origin at the average position of the intersection points. Now, when we calculate the pseudo-inverse, we get the point on the edge that is closest to the average position. A common way to find the pseudo-inverse is by using the singular value decomposition. Now, instead of finding the exact solution, we're performing minimization of the quadratic error function. There are other mathematical tools to do this. This should also give the right solution in the previous two cases, but if all normals point roughly in the same direction, then there is no point doing this computation. This is how Hermite data is used to preserve the sharp features. Next, we'll cover the ambiguous cases in 2D and 3D. Marching squares has two ambiguous cases, where checkerboard pattern of signs is formed at cell corners. The Booleans at corners are equal, but these meshes clearly need to be handled differently. Cubical marching squares solves this by creating new vertices as we did before and seeing which of the two options doesn't lead to intersecting geometry. Here our first attempt fails, because the segments are intersecting. The second option doesn't cause intersecting geometry. Similar problem exists in 3D called the internal ambiguity. You can either connect a tunnel through the cell or create triangle fan at each corners. Again, if using separate triangle fans leads to intersecting sharp features, then you use the other option instead. The slight issue here is that it is non-trivial to create a triangle mesh to connect two of these components. In a uniform grid, you will have limited number of segments in both loops, but that's not true in an Octree. In the paper, they've only said that they use dynamic programming algorithm to connect these components. Now that we've covered all the modifications on uniform grid, we have all the improvements except adaptive resolution. To get adaptive refinement of the mesh, we'll use the algorithm in an Octree instead of in uniform grid. We'll take this opportunity to go over all the steps to produce a mesh. First, we compute the Hermite data. Again, sine distance functions were used to get the Hermite data, but you could use a triangle mesh or any other representation that can be converted to Hermite data. To form the Hermite data, you want to sample the sines at the cell corners first, and then you use those sampled values to find the edges with sine change. This way, it's guaranteed that you can detect an intersection on every edge that needs to have a vertex. The resolution at which you sample the Hermite data determines the maximal depth for the Octree, and thus the maximum level of detail. You can't have more than one intersection on each edge at the finest resolution. Now we create an Octree root cell that encloses the entire surface we want to generate. Next, we need to manually subdivide this Octree such that the edges intersect with the geometry. As the third step, we start subdividing the Octree based on intersections on the edges of each cell. If any edge of a cell has more than one intersection, we always subdivide it until there's only one left, removing all edge ambiguities. We also subdivide if there's only one intersection per edge, but the normals point in different directions. This is an heuristic to assign more detail to complex surfaces. The threshold can be configured and determines the amount of detail captured. Recursively repeating this until maximum depth is reached gets us the final Octree. During subdivision, we have to capture the relationships between cell faces and edges because they are shared by multiple cells. A face is shared by two cells, and the cells could be subdivided at different levels. If one cell is subdivided further, then the cell with less detail essentially sees a quad tree of faces as its face. This will be important during the last surface extraction step. Not handling this correctly leads to cracks in the mesh. We also need to be able to uniquely identify intersections to connect them together later. Now we can proceed to the fourth step. We run marching squares algorithm on each leaf face with a sine change. Just like before, we add sharp features and resolve 2D ambiguities. As the final step, we extract the surface by iterating all leaf cells. We have to collect the segments on each face of a cell where each face is a quad tree of faces. The segments are essentially edges between vertices and form a graph. Once you've collected all segments, you can find loops in this graph, up to four components per cell. For each component, you detect 3D sharp feature and resolve the ambiguous cases. You form a triangle fan from each component, and you'll have the whole mesh. Now we can mesh almost anything. You can sample the Hermite data at different resolutions to get different levels of detail. Finally, let's summarize the key differences to marching cubes. Marching cubes doesn't preserve sharp features. Cubical marching squares solves this by placing new vertices on cell faces and inside the cell. Marching cubes can produce meshes with holes due to ambiguous cases. Cubical marching squares solves this issue by resolving face ambiguities and by always producing same segments on adjacent cell faces. In addition, it tries to resolve internal ambiguity for the diagonal case. Marching cubes produces entire mesh with the same resolution. Chosen cell size sets the level of detail globally. Using different resolutions for adjacent cells produces cracks in the mesh and needs additional patching. Cubical marching squares can do adaptive refinement, using smaller cells where needed, without requiring additional patching steps. Marching cubes only require scalar data at each cell corner and optionally intersection point on edges with a sign change for more precision. Cubical marching squares requires Hermite data, which means that in addition to scalar values, it also needs normals at intersection point of each edge with a sign change. Marching cubes implementations normally use one large lookup table with all 256 cases. Cubical marching squares only requires the lookup table for marching squares, which is 16 cases, along with the two alternative connections for ambiguous cases. However, the complexity lies in tracking the connections between cells, their faces, and edges. For efficient implementation, you'll need some additional small lookup tables to track those connections. Cubical marching squares keeps the intercell independence unlike many other similar algorithms. Here's a comparison table from the paper. Thanks for watching.